Peace, infinite waters, diving deep once again. Oh yes, this is Teal Swan. Do you know who she is? Of course you do. Yes, the spiritual catalyst. And we're going to be diving deep.
Yes, and for those of you who are on my channel, who should know who this is, probably do already, this is Ralph Smart from Infinite Waters. One of my favorite people to talk to by far. And today we're going to be talking about authenticity and how to be authentic. So how do you define authenticity?
Well, where should we start? For me, authenticity really is not being able to be swayed by the crowd, by the gladiator arena, which is all around us, from parents to friends to work colleagues. And it's tough. And what about you?
To me, I feel like authenticity, rather than being the presence of something, which is what we usually look at authenticity like, it's more the absence of inauthenticity. So I want people to start thinking about their true selves almost like it's a light. And there are all these things that obscure that light. So if we can find those inauthenticities, and remove those from our being, you don't have to work at becoming authentic. That's sort of the issue, is that when it comes to becoming authentic, it's almost like we're going for something that we already have. So.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I feel in today's day and age, you probably have a lot to say about this social media world where there's Instagram, YouTube, Facebook. And what I've noticed is that a lot of people, it's about the likes, it's about the views. That equates to self-worth. So I think it's very difficult to be authentic. How do you think one goes around that in terms of just sharing themselves? But if they don't find this popular, do they still continue or do they just stop and be someone else?
I think it starts by getting sick of yourself, to be honest. I mean, I would love it to be a more glamorous story, but I feel like real authenticity always comes on the heels of somebody realizing just how painful it is to be living in a way where you've got that sort of stressful discomfort of knowing that you have to really try hard to pretend to be something different than how you are. So I like to explain to people that the idea of authenticity revolves around one central, it's like the sun, so everything's revolving around the sun, right? And that sun for inauthenticity revolves around wanting to look good. That's what we have to get. All authenticity is about wanting to look good. It's about the social group. So if we can acknowledge in our lives the areas that where we want to look the best, you can find your inauthenticities. And then it's about calling them out. With the ego, it's very difficult to eradicate any aspect of the ego. We have to essentially embrace it, notice it. And it's sort of the allowing of that instead of the resistance of that, but also the awareness of it that allows it to dissipate on its own.
Right, right. Well, in ancient Greece, they had the theater where they would wear a mask. It was like a ritual. And even though they were acting, they were aware they were acting, but that's why it was so powerful. They were aware they were playing this character. I feel when you do that, then you can still be authentic. At the same time, yes, you can be someone else.
Yes.
But you realize that's just another part of yourself.
Yeah, I feel like that is a big problem when it comes to inauthenticity, is that most people who are inauthentic don't even know it. It's like you wear the mask so long, it starts to become part of your face.
You start to wear it. You start to own it.
Yeah.
And do you feel that the fear of being authentic outweighs the fear of being inauthentic?
In today's world, I would say so.
Right.
Unfortunately, yes. But I think that many of us who are watching this particular session are at a point in life where it's become too exhausting. And so it's like, no matter how scared you are, you're almost ready to commit ego suicide and like, you know, just call it as it is. But that, of course, requires us to first embark on this little journey of getting to know ourselves, because you can't know what's inauthentic until you know what's authentic, right? Or you can't know what's authentic until you know what's inauthentic. It works both ways. So to know thyself, essentially, is the first step. Now, this requires us to be super honest. This is the issue that I watch even with the majority of my clients, is that when you try to get somebody to be honest, they'll spend 15 minutes fighting me on their honesty before they're really honest. Because we live according to shoulds. Should is the absolute enemy of authenticity. Like, the absolute enemy. And especially in the spiritual field. Why? Because in the spiritual field, we've got to be good people, nice people. We should not have ego. And so, like, if that's the truth for you, you can't admit to it. Because you are going to have everybody look down on you. It's one of the main reasons why I chose authenticity as the platform for my entire career. It's because...
Right.
I'm sick of it. I'm sick of the velvet curtain, essentially, that exists around right. all spiritual teachers, where there's an unwillingness to say, because the consequences, and there are. I can't tell you how many times I've been like, hey, look, guys, I'm having relationship issues. They're, you know, I get emails where they're like, I can't take relationship advice from anyone who has relationship problems. And I'm like, well, have fun finding a teacher. But at the same time, it's interesting. You'll get to a point where the consequence, you know, those kind of consequences is not as big as the consequence of living out of alignment or out of integrity with your own personal truth. It's too painful, frankly.
Right.
Did you ever have a point like that in your life?
Definitely. That's why my main motto is being free is your birthright. That's why I consider you such a great friend. And a lot of people who watch my videos, they watch your videos and they're like, wow, these are my two favorite people sharing. And it's wonderful because it's worth it. I always tell people, if you go through it, it's worth it. But at the same time, it's not easy.
Yes.
Freedom is for the brave. And people that go on that journey, you might have to end some relationships, some friendships. Some people may not walk with you all the way. So I think that's what keeps a lot of people from being authentic, because they don't want to be alone.
Oh, yeah.
Where is everyone? Example.
It scares the crap out of me. Like, I'm facing that fear, which you kind of have to do in order to be authentic. You got to face the fear of being alone, because that's the very thing, the monster, essentially, that's chasing you into inauthenticity. But it scares the crap out of me. I'll just be honest about it. You know, the idea that like, if I'm completely me, it's going to be me alone in the ballroom. It's scary.
Right.
But what I find, the interesting thing that I find is, what's causing the actual loneliness that I feel is not the lack of other people. It's the fact that I abandoned myself in the first place. So we got to think about ourselves kind of like the junction between two aspects of ourselves. And when we decided to become inauthentic or not live according to our feelings or our truth, we essentially jumped away from ourselves. And so it's that that's actually causing the majority of the loneliness. If I come back to being truly present with myself, the loneliness dissipates. It's quite interesting.
Yes, that's so true. I always tell people that there's a reason why you see Buddha alone. There's a reason why you see Jesus alone, because you have to go in the wilderness to find yourself, and you become powerful beyond measure. Only few are willing to go on that journey, but the few that do, they end up inspiring the world. They are there for that specific reason, to become the lighthouse. The lighthouse is alone for a reason. To shine the light. But it's alone. But it's powerful. And naturally, you attract so many people towards you. Like, so many people love Teal.
Really?
So many people, right? Because that's the power of being vulnerable. So many of us, we want to act like everything is rosy. And I feel that's why so many people connect with you, because you show people, okay, you're just living an ordinary life in extraordinary circumstances, you see. And that's why you're so relatable. Me too. So I just feel with spirituality, there's a great trap. And also in authenticity, where a lot of people, they try to be righteous. They say, okay, I want to be Mr. Righteous, Mrs. Righteous, and I call it the righteousness trap, where it's just like in the film Titanic. Everyone is having fun at the bottom of the boat, while on the top, everyone is trying to act like they're so perfect and so authentic, because everyone on the bottom of the boat, they're breaking the rules.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel that people, you can still be authentic, but at the same time, explore your wild side. Because some people might say, well, you're not yourself. You've changed. Of course I've changed. What do you expect? everything is changing in nature. Leaves are changing different colors, but at the same time, at the core, the essence remains.
That's what makes it authentic change.
Right.
Exactly. Yeah, like the ego, basically, we have to understand the ego rides on the concept of good and bad, on the concept of right and wrong, on the concept of should and shouldn't. So anytime we've got these polarizations and we're trying to be on the right side of that polarization, the ego is present and inauthenticity is lost. We got to think about that relative to our own lives, especially because we've got a lot of judgments that we make about the rest of the world, and that actually prevents us from our own authenticity. Isn't that interesting?
Crazy.
And then, so when it comes to getting to know yourself, I'm interested to know your opinion when it comes to getting to know yourself. I tell people that it's really, really critical that you start to know what you like and what you don't like, what you want, what you don't want. Your core values, for example, that's super critical. Everybody has different values. We'd assume they'd be the same, but they're not. You got to know what your priorities are and be super, like, honest about that. Being honest about it is like one of the most difficult aspects of this self-awareness process. You know, when you're looking at your priorities, I had to do this the other day where it was like, I'm looking at the way that I'm structuring my life and had to admit that in my life, I have this, you know, cultural belief that my son should be the priority in my life over everything. But when I look at the way that I organize my time, my career gets the priority. So it's about, am I going to admit which really is the priority for me? Even though I might meet with lots of judgment, even self-judgment, about the fact that my career obviously is the priority. You know? See, it's like even saying that, I can feel the resistance come up in me. I want to pretend that I'm, you know, the best mom in the world, and that the truth is that I prioritize him over everything in my life. But I can't. I can't do that and be authentic, so.
Right, right. Well, I find what you're saying happens to me. For instance, I've got my sister, my mom, and even my ex-partner. Whenever I was around them, I love being around them, but at the same time, I felt like I can only be authentic. I could only be authentic when I was sharing in my true authenticity. At the same time, I'm here judging myself, saying, come on, priorities. What matters the most? Is this really who you are, or are you... can you let all of that go? So I think that's also difficult to juggle. But at the same time, I always say, when you are in your authenticity, you allow other people to be in their authenticity.
Totally. Yes, so, I love that. I love that. That little, like, that train effect. I love that.
Right, right. And it's so important for people to realize that you wouldn't have connected with so many millions of people you have if you didn't take that first brave step to say, okay, this is who I am. I'm going to share my journey, what's happened to me, ritual abuse, and all kinds of things. That's not easy to do. But because of that, because you've dived so deep, you've connected with the most authentic people as well.
Yes, that's for damn sure. Yes.
Right. You see, and I'm sure people write you all kinds of stuff, but it's only because you've expressed your vulnerability.
Yes.
But I definitely feel whenever you're living in this world, you also have to be a balancer. You have to be a juggler. And I feel juggling is fantastic because it shows us we have so many gifts. We can be at two places at once.
Yeah, it's great until the balls all fall.
until the balls all fall down on the floor, but we can. We can definitely do it, but at the same time, we should never feel guilty for something which we're not. And I always quote, say that Krishnamurti quote, who says, you know, it's no measure of health to be well adjusted to a profoundly sick society.
That's one of my favorites.
Oh, it is. It is.
It's so good and so true. So do you find that, I find that asking why is one of the most critical things if we want to find our authenticity. Because also that'll show you new dimensions as to why you've chosen the things that you have chosen, why you like the things you like, why you have the values that you have. And that question, of course, for people that are worried that they've chosen the wrong thing for themselves, that will reveal whether you have chosen something from a place of inauthenticity or authenticity. For example, if I, like in the previous scenario, let's say that I asked myself, why is it that in my life I prioritize my career over my son? you know, if you're going to watch my actions. Basically, I come up with both positive aspects and some shadow aspects. Some shadow aspects about my past, about the fact that it's a little bit nerve-wracking to be completely responsible for a small child who is near the same age as when I was first abused, see? So that's the shadow aspect. That might be an indication that I am avoiding him not because it's the sort of authentic truth of what I want in my being, but because of some sort of fear. That's an authentic truth. Also, you've got to the polar opposite side of that, because we have to understand that as humans, we hold dichotomies, big, massive dichotomies. That's that juggling thing, even within our own personality structure. So to the opposite effect, if I ask myself, why do I prioritize it? It's because this is what lights my life up. This is where I feel my greatest sense of purpose. Some women are literally lit up, I mean like totally from the bottom up, by taking care of another human being, especially children. I am not one of those women. I am happier than a clam when I'm on stage talking and doing things like this. But like,
well, that's wonderful you can be honest about it. You see, I always say to people, own your honesty.
Oh yeah.
And then great things happen, because once again, once you're so powerful, you can do other things. Well, you can even question why.
It's true, but even people watching this video, like, and this is the reason I want to bring this up, because a lot of people who will be watching this video, when I say the words that I just said, that authenticity about myself, they will feel the resistance in their own being. There will be judgment. There will be a, oh my gosh. Yes.
There will definitely be judgment, but at the same time, who's judging? You see, we have to remind ourselves that if we take on board other people's judgments, we become the judge. You see, everything is happening based on our own observation. That's the greatest trick of the mind. You see, there are no other people. You see, we are writing the script for every single person on planet Earth.
Yes.
We think people are thinking about us. People have got to do other stuff. They've got to put the food on the stove. People are busy. So we are always thinking about what other people think, which once again keeps us out of our authenticity, because we're trying to live to a social norm which really doesn't exist.
Yes.
And we're trying to compare ourselves to maybe other parents.
Oh yeah. You see, I have to tell you, this is a good story. I got a good story ready. I'm throwing myself right under the bus. I have this woman who lives on my street, right? And it's now a family joke, because basically she's the quintessential stay-at-home mom, but not like the trophy wife. She's the kind of mom who's constantly riding bicycles with her sons, like doing cookie rounds or, you know, basically. And here I am like coming back from my umpteenth trip to Europe or something like that. And I'm going to my son's PTA meetings. I don't even know what the hell they're talking about half the time at those things. And I'm just like, oh man, I end up in tears. But it's like every single time this woman passes me, I can feel myself flare up with this like this lack of self-worth, because I feel like I should be more like that, you know?
Definitely.
And it's tempting. It's super tempting to then walk upstairs, change my whole wardrobe, you know, like try to mimic that behavior, because I feel like that is the good person thing to do.
Well, it comes down to values once again, because everything is based on value.
Yeah.
Numbers, you see, and being a good parent, a good mother, a lot of people equate that to a very high value.
Mm.
You see, in our society. So once again, if we adhere to that value system, then it's going to be very difficult to really feel free in our hearts. But if we don't, then we can sleep at night. So we have to once again question our own value system, not what other people value, but our own value system. Then it becomes very clearer, and we can become more authentic in a very pure and simple way.
Exactly. And then you get to ask yourself also, as a parent too, this will go for every parent watching, you'll have a point in your life essentially where you have to question yourself what you're teaching your child. So like, I mean, it's a loving thing to teach your child that they're the number one priority in your life. But if you're trying to teach them that and it's not the actual truth, A, they will feel it, and B, you are teaching them to live inauthentically. So I have, at the end of the day, I have to ask myself, do I want him to be completely authentic? If that's the truth, I better be completely authentic.
Yes, yes, you see. And a lot of the children right now, they're very advanced. They're aware. They're fully aware.
Oh, yeah.
You see, I think our generation, our parents' generation, they were less compassionate. in terms of just from the pressure of society, but we're living in a whole new world. I just definitely feel that anyone who has a hard time being authentic, we have to really, like I always say, own your weirdness.
Yes. Own your weirdness.
Own your weirdness. Own your weirdness. You see, everyone is really mad. Just like in Alice in Wonderland, everyone is super mad. And everyone is really trying their hardest to act like normal.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm the perfect mom. I work in the perfect job. I have the perfect relationship. I have the perfect family. And then your family is yelling at you in the house. And you're like, oh, I hope no one sees this.
I know.
Imagine if there was a secret camera in your house, right? You don't want that. So it's really, we have to show people our weirdness to move more into our authenticity.
So I want you to give your suggestions about how people can tune into their own inauthenticities. I like to tell people, basically, that I was talking with a non-physical guide, a spirit guide, this one day, and what he said to me is that if there is any resistance present within the being, there is always inauthenticity present. And it's still to this day, it takes me a while to think about that. But I've made it a practice in my own life, whenever I feel any kind of discomfort, like any discomfort at all, to ask myself, how am I being inauthentic in this very moment? And usually what I'll find is, I'm feeling uncomfortable because somebody's asked me to do, this is one of my patterns, I'm feeling uncomfortable because somebody has asked me to do something I don't want to do. And the second that I actually express, I don't really want to do that, that discomfort actually goes away. Which you'd think it'd be the opposite. You'd think that if you voice that, it would get way, way worse. But it's almost like the second we admit to our truth, the rest of it just falls away. So what is your suggestion for people?
Well, just then I just relaxed a bit, right? Get more authentic. Because it's all about, I always talk about the body, you see, and breathing deep from the base of our spine, but also just seeing how tight or relaxed our muscles are. Once you're very relax, all of a sudden you can breathe very freely and you have this calm into your body where really and truly it allows you to be authentic. You see, many of us are inauthentic in our body before we even say anything or do anything.
Well, what would you say to the people in the spiritual field who say that your body is an inauthentic illusion?
Well, I always say that there's so many ways to look at it, but the body essentially is a vehicle. You see, we're driving, we're the one who's governing this ship. We have to take responsibility for it. It's just like a reckless driver. Of course, you're going to blame, if there's a car crash, it's the driver, because the car is just doing what the driver is telling it to do.
Mm-hmm.
You see, so it's still part of the driver's responsibility, just like our body. So if for instance, Fritz Perls, the great psychologist, he was counseling a client. The client was biting her teeth and she was saying, I'm fine. And then Fritz Perls said, no, you're not, because your body isn't showing me you're fine.
Yes.
But she said, I'm fine. You see, so Fritz Perls always used to say, lose your mind and come to your senses.
Yes.
How you express yourself in your body is really a clue to how you're living in your daily life. Some people say, oh, I really love this person, but once again, their body doesn't show it when they're with them.
Yep. That's my issue, actually, also. That was actually a very big wake-up call for me on my authenticity path, is that I started to become very good at being authentic with stuff that wasn't good. And then I was very inauthentic with love and things that were positive. That actually felt more vulnerable to me. So what you said just then, a lot of times, like, I would notice myself in relationships, authentically, I would want to reach out and touch someone, but I wouldn't be letting myself do it because of X, Y, and Z. So I'm like, I totally love that you just brought that up, because I completely see it, even in my own life. I also like to tell people, basically, that the spirit, we basically have got to understand that the soul or the spirit is expressing itself on a physical level, is expressing itself on an emotional level, and is expressing itself on a mental level. So our goal when it comes to authenticity is knowing ourselves at all of those levels. That includes the body. And when we're walking around, you know, trying to convince ourselves that our body is completely an illusion and that the best and highest state is to remove yourself from anything physical, we're missing out on a piece of our authentic expression. For sure.
Definitely. Well, it's the same as clothing. Once again, that's also part of your authentic experience and authentic creation. A lot of people say, well, why are you so material? You see, once again, they fall into the righteousness trap, where they just want to strip down to the robes.
Yep.
I say, be careful. You're going to be cold out there. So,
it's totally true.
Yeah.
I've noticed that your style has sort of changed since last time we talked. Have you noticed that?
Oh yeah. I'm relaxing more. Once again, it's a whole process to really relax.
Oh, good.
And really have more fun.
Yeah, I noticed that... people are super judgmental in terms of what package, that's the more the inauthenticity thing, it's I'm pretending to be spiritual. What package should spirituality come to me in? It should definitely come in the form of somebody who's on a hilltop. It should come in the form of somebody who's wearing a certain type of clothing. And I gotta tell you, it's one of my favorite things to throw a wrench in the socket of that one. A long time ago, I had to ask myself, like, what is my favorite way of dressing? And the answer was caftans and saris. No, I'm not Indian. So a lot of people would look at me and be like, oh my God, she's trying too hard. But that's actually, if I'm thinking about the way that my soul would express itself, that is what it would look like. So it's been a real challenge, though, to like walk around town wearing those outfits and have people stop and look at me like, what the hell is going on? I can't compute this, you know?
Well, it's the same. I'm in Venice a lot every year, and I'm a skater. And a lot of people might say, oh, you're a black guy who skates. And I always tell people, who said I was black? Who said I was any color? I'm a infinite being, you see? So it's a whole case where just as long as you know yourself, there's nothing to worry about.
What?
I connect with so many different people every single day. And the secret I've tapped into, there's a great spiritual, my mentor, whose name was Omran Mikhail Ivanov. I don't know if you've heard of him, but this guy was incredible. I don't even consider him like a guru or anything. He was just a phenomenal being. But he would talk about never resting on your laurels. You see, the reason why a lot of people stop being authentic, especially when they're really successful, people say, oh, money changes you, fame changes you. Here's the reason why. What happens is that people reach a pinnacle and they start believing the hype, but also they start judging their own work based on other people's expectations, but also they start giving people what they want. So the secret around that, and I learned this like maybe a year ago, I just put out videos. Like I don't even watch the views or the likes. I have no interest in that. Why? It's not because I don't care. It's because the only way I can be authentic is when I don't spend all the time wondering what everyone else is thinking, because someone could say something and I could be there thinking for an hour. I don't want to do that. You see, I would rather it come to me naturally.
Yes.
About what I've got to change, not what someone else thinks I've got to change. And that way you can just create. But also many people, they start waiting. You know, they might create something and they wait until someone says, oh, that's amazing. Oh, that's not good. You don't need anyone else's opinion, to be honest, perfectly honest. You see, art doesn't need for someone to say, oh, that's amazing. Art in itself is just an expression.
Mm-hmm.
There's no good or bad or like or dislike. You can't like or dislike art. And this is what everyone is doing. We are all artists. So whatever someone has to share is fantastic because it's a part of who they are.
Have you found a way to teach people to be okay with having no approval?
Well, I always say, have fun. Have a lot of fun. And I love seeing, I watch a lot of other YouTubers and it's wonderful what they're doing. I'm also a fan of what they're doing. Just doing videos about making a cup of tea. I think that's awesome. How authentic, you can't get more authentic than that, because that's like the existential kind of living, you see. So I always tell people that you don't have to go over the top. You don't have to put on a massive show for people. You don't have to win people's approval. You just have to win your own. Once you can become your own greatest fan and at least clap for yourself and say, gosh, I did a great job. It's amazing. What's happened, though, a lot of people, they've fallen into what I call the humble trap.
Oh, I hate that one. I already know about that one.
You already know it. So you got to be careful about being too humble.
Oh, ooh. You know, the spiritual community is full of that one. I have no need for ego gratification anymore. The ego's like, I just came in the back door.
And how about you? What would you say has been the biggest obstacle from when you first started sharing with the world to where you are right now? You've grown so much. You've connected with so many amazing people. You've gone to so many different countries. Is the inspiration still there for you?
Yes.
Is the passion still there for you?
Yes.
Is the authenticity? Of course it's there. But do you feel like you can really be yourself 100%?
I find that the more that I agree to doing other people's like events, the harder it is. So basically I can stay the way that it is, and honestly I think that coming into the world as a spiritual teacher is probably the best thing I could do for the authenticity piece, because you start to realize that you can't make anybody happy. Like, you really can't. It gets to the point where it's like, one person gives me a suggestion, I want approval, so I follow that suggestion, and then a whole other group of people hates what I did. So it's like, you're damned if you do, damned if you don't. And the blessing of a damned if you do, damned if you don't scenario, where you're going to get disapproval either way from different groups, is you just literally are left with what is most true to me. Because there's nowhere else to turn if you're going to get disapproval one way or the other, you see. So it's kind of, I've been forced into a corner, and I think that's a really good thing, where I'm in that position. But what gets really hard is when I'm at the position that I'm at now, I'm getting hired for these events with companies that definitely do want me to behave in a certain way. And I have a real reputation, shall I say, for being very raw and swearing and, you know, that kind of stuff. And so a lot of people will tell me to tone it down because they don't want to lose followers. And so then I get put in a real bind where it's like, okay, here are these people who are basically paying me, and they want me to represent them. But they're telling me that in order to represent them, I have to adhere to their values. And so that has been by far the hardest tightrope, I think, to walk. And I've had to scrub way more than a few opportunities based on just telling them, like, you don't really want me. You think you want me, but what you want is my views. What you want is my following. And the reality is that I'm not going to be silenced. So, yeah, it's been a real challenge.
Well, there's someone once said, freedom is when you have nothing left to lose. So I say authenticity is when you have nothing left to lose. So
yes.
I always tell people, imagine it's your last 24 hours on planet Earth.
Yes.
What would you do and what would you say if you had only 24 hours left? Nobody would care. So why not do it right now? And that's really fearless living. But once again, we can only really do that once we have nothing left to lose. And I feel for so many people being authentic, the secret is what you're doing, what I'm doing, what so many other people are doing, which is really moving, making your job a lifestyle.
Yes.
Like Teal Swan, what does she do? It's a heaven. You
it's
love
heaven.
What you do. I can tell.
Yes.
I know you love what you do. And it's phenomenal that you've created it. And you've shared with so many people. And you're encouraging other people to do it. So I feel that's the next step of authenticity. That's the next step of authenticity. When you make your job a lifestyle. When there is no separation.
I completely agree. But so what would you say to people, because I've noticed that another issue with authenticity is the conflict. People who want to avoid conflict, obviously, have a real hard time with authenticity. So,
well, for instance, I'll give you an example. I've been doing YouTube videos for a long time. So I'm like a YouTube nerd in studying what people like. Sometimes I put thumbnails of other people just to see, just to have a little fun. And it's fascinating how the human mind works. You see, many of us are, we're drawn to, how can I say it? Entertainment, you see. So when we talk of conflict, a lot of people, they don't want to say anything, you see, because they don't want to, many people are afraid of being exposed.
Yep.
That's the real secret. That's what we're all interested in, because we know that's the next step to authenticity. If you've got someone saying, screw the world, we're going to probably be more interested in that person than someone saying peace and love. Why? Because the person who is saying screw the world, you know that they're basically, they're not going to give you what you want to hear. They're going to give you something which is really going to ruffle your feathers and shake your belief system, right? So I always, you know, that's the next step. Really, to avoid conflict, you have to realize that you are going to be in the gladiator arena. You see, there is no spectator seat for you. Everybody is a gladiator. Yep. And you have to be prepared that not everybody is going to like you.
Yes.
Deal with it, you see. You see, I think what you should actually do is really go back into time and just realize how certain people were burnt on the stake, certain people were stoned to death over a little thing.
Uh-huh.
You see, so don't worry about if someone gives you a dislike on a video or on a Facebook post. It's really not the end of the world, but that should never matter to you. Just like in the film Lucy, which is a great film about the power of the mind, she says there are no numbers. Can you imagine if we realize really and truly there are no numbers? I always tell people it doesn't matter if someone has 1 million or 10 million followers on Instagram or 100 followers, because each person represents a collective whole. You see, each person is part of the fabric. You see, a lot of us, we avoid really sharing ourselves because, once again, we feel it's, who cares about it?
I care.
I care. Put your hand up. We care. We care. You see, and that's why we're all drawn to artists, because they share, but a lot of the times they share because they have an audience, so they can share their authenticity. See, many people, they don't really want to share their authenticity because they feel it's not valuable to anybody. So then they end up saying, well, who I am is boring because no one cares about it. So I'll tell you what, let me create this character where people can find me more interesting, and then they actually lose the connection of who they really were.
Which is more interesting always, I find.
Oh yeah, definitely. It's always more interesting.
Yeah. So I want people who are watching this to ask themselves the question. I have been acting like fill in the blank, when in fact, fill in the blank. And I want them to basically take out a sheet of paper and fill out that question as many times as they can. I really like this practice when it comes to authenticity. Because you'll sort of start on little things, and then you'll have that one thing come out where you're like, oh my gosh, that's the real inauthenticity that I am essentially upholding. And when it comes to replacing inauthenticity with authenticity, you have to basically first notice the inauthenticity. Then you have to basically get to a point where you are, I hate the word acceptance, but it's almost like allowing. You're allowing the inauthenticity. So you're not resisting it, and you're also not like fueling it. You're just literally witnessing. It's a detached witnessing of it. Ah, I see that. I have that inauthenticity. Then we basically take any step we can to go from inauthenticity to authenticity. And a lot of times that has to do with calling ourselves out. This is where authentic communication comes in, which I think is one of the most incredibly important aspects to understand about authenticity. We have to learn how to authentically communicate with other people. And part of that is going to be real scary. It's us exposing ourselves for what is really going on. So my new favorite practice, I don't know if you guys, one of my last videos was on meaning the self-destruct button. And
I love that.
But in the moment, right, I've noticed that there is this tendency towards inauthenticity. Like, let's say you and I are in a relationship, and you let's say you come home a half an hour late, right, and that bothers me. Inauthenticity in that moment would be for me to either cold shoulder you or pretend like I was totally fine with it, because I want to be a cool girlfriend that doesn't have those emotional issues. But in that moment, here's authentic communication. It's about the meaning. What am I making this mean? We're not honest with each other in the moment about that. So like, if we want an authentic communication, I would walk up to you and I'd say, okay, you got home 30 minutes late. I am making this mean that I'm not important to you. Is that true?
That's powerful. I'm mm-hmm. gonna have to start using that. Right.
It's like it has transformed my relationships. Like literally transformed them overnight. Just that one practice. And it keeps me in a place where I have to be authentic about the things that I'm doing and the insecurities that I have.
Right. So just repeat that again, just for those to catch it, people to catch it.
Okay, in the moment, essentially, that you feel yourself having resistance towards somebody else or towards something, something's not okay to you or is making you uncomfortable, that is the moment that you've got to look at yourself in terms of what am I making this situation mean? Because it's the meaning that we're adding to the events that's actually causing us the amount of pain, and it's that meaning that makes us really inauthentic. So when we get into that conflict, basically, we have to be willing to say, all right, let's give me a scenario. Give me another scenario, and I'll give you an example of how I would do this practically. Of like a scenario where maybe they'd upset you recently. Just tell me anything.
Okay. Certain friends, for example, may have taken it the wrong way at work. Or maybe you didn't speak to them at work when you were working.
Okay. So, all right, so let's say that you've got these people who, and you're saying they're the ones that have the issue?
Right, right, because you didn't give them enough attention when you were doing some work.
Okay,
and
they
should have gone out with them.
There we go. So here we have the opportunity for inauthenticity, because we can't control them, see? So that's the opportunity for inauthenticity is us trying to control them. Authenticity is we get to be completely responsible for ourselves. So in this scenario, you would say, all right, so if they are saying that I am not giving them enough attention, why is that an issue?
Right, right.
For you, why is that an issue for you?
Well, if I'm not giving them enough attention, I feel like I should become a better friend.
Okay, so in the moment, if you're going to be authentic, you would walk up to them and you'd say, all right now, because I'm perceiving that you think that I am taking too much time for this, I am making that mean that I'm not a good enough friend to you. And I'm also potentially making that mean that you want to be more important to me than my career. And I'm also making that mean, see, it can be several things. It's about what is the meaning that you're adding to that. I'm making it mean that there's going to be a conflict between what I love and my passion and being with you.
Right, right. That's super, super powerful. Well, Dr. Joe Dispenza talks about the placebo effect, which is very similar. And he talks of three things that governs any placebo. And it's really funny because it's really meaning, it's conditioning, and I forgot the other one. I'm being authentic here. I'll find the other one. But meaning and conditioning. You see, all of those things play a part. You see, in a placebo. You see, placebos are all about making something happen. You see, by really there not being an actual, that thing being doing anything in the first place, just like a sugar pill. And most of our lives is like our relationship with a sugar pill.
Yes.
It works because we believe it does, or it doesn't work because we believe it doesn't work.
Completely.
You see, so what he says is that we are the placebo.
And
that's what I've realized as well along my journey. That's what I share with people. And really just realizing once again that we're almost going around trying to tiptoe through life. It's impossible.
Well, yeah, you step on the cracks anyways.
You're going to step on cracks anyways, you see. So I feel that that's the thing. When actually you go into, when you start taking giant leaps, you see, sometimes I feel you can really be authentic when you don't have this fear of being a bad person.
Oh, man, see, that is an issue.
You see, everybody wants to be a good person because word gets around. People will say, I get emails all the time, and really thousands of emails. And sometimes people ask me something, sometimes people book a session and I don't get back to them. And they're saying, gosh, I just shared this personal information with you. You're so bad for not getting back to me. And I'm thinking, oh man, I don't want them to say anything bad about me.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to have a bad name. So sometimes I'm like, let me just send them an email to maybe keep them quiet. And then I'm like, do I really want to do that? Or do I just really want to say I don't? And then what helped me was realizing, actually, I'm not a bad person. I'm doing just fine. And really, I'm great. And it's just amazing when you say, I'm not a bad person. I know I'm not, because of everything I've done. And I see myself, like, just like Carl Rogers said, the great psychologist, with unconditional positive regard. That's the greatest way. Unconditional positive regard.
I agree. Because,
yeah.
And I think that you're in a very high vibration relative to that subject, because if I'm going to be completely honest, I still, even regardless of what I do in the world, I still don't feel like a good person. And I've noticed basically that the closest that I get to feeling like a good person is authenticity. It's that moment where basically I'm completely in alignment with my integrity, whether that integrity is savory or sour. I can feel my virtue for the first time. But like, if I was to say the words, I feel like a good person or I am a good person, it would feel like a complete lie.
Right. It can work like that. I just feel...
So what would you say to somebody like that?
For someone who says...
That it's a lie. Like all of those words. You know, if they were to look at themselves in the mirror and say, I'm a good person, and they know it's a lie, or they feel like it's a lie. What would you tell them?
Once again, I always talk of what I call, I'm going to do a video on it, which I call positive imprint programs. There has been a time where you've literally gone out of your way to go and help someone.
Yes.
You know you didn't have to. You have to write that down in your diary as a positive imprint to in your subconscious mind.
Yes.
And then read those diaries every now and again. And what you're going to find is that you're going to realize, because a lot of the times we do so many amazing things that we even forget. Just like we've gone through so much that once again, we even forget how strong we are.
Yes.
So someone who doesn't feel like they're a good person, you have to keep a check of all your good deeds. You have to write them down, but more so you have to pay yourself more homage, you see.
Yes.
And you can only do that once you actually remember what you've done.
I love that idea. You want to know something that I found out that's interesting?
Right.
I've noticed that there's motive in a lot of us, we get into these double binds, you'll find. The more damned if you do and damned if you don't scenarios. So one of the double binds, and this is going to relate directly to authenticity, one of the double binds for people who chronically feel like they're not good is that they can't resource, which is what you're talking about, where you basically look at how good you are. Why don't we sit down and write that list even after you tell us to? It's because we still think there's virtue in essentially punishing ourselves. It's that right. Martyrdom complex. And so we're actually trying to be good by hurting ourselves.
Mm. I agree.
Painful. We have to look at manipulation too. I wanted to explain before we moved on too that we have to look at two things also in our life. It's how we manipulate people. And also the facades that we keep up. And facades are quite kind of interesting when you look at it in terms of complaint. If you have a persistent complaint that never goes away, chances are there's a facade there. For example, let's say that somebody has a persistent complaint about, let's say, disappointment. We have to be willing to consider that there's an actual payoff for disappointment. It's a way that we can skirt responsibility. And so while we're complaining about that thing, the truth is another part of us, a more deep part of us, actually enjoys maintaining that state. That's another level that we have to look at of inauthenticity. And also manipulation. All manipulation on the planet Earth, I think it's funny that we've made a demon out of that word, but all manipulation is, essentially, is a person that cannot ask for what they need up front.
Very true.
I mean, why else would I do that? All manipulation is, I can't ask you. I can't come up to you and say, and this is a good one for those of you that like rescue. I'll manipulate a scenario where basically you have to rescue me because I want comfort, ultimately. And it's not okay when you're 30 years old or however old you are to come up to somebody like me and you, if you and I were in a relationship, and say, look, I need you to comfort me right now. So I have to basically manufacture and manipulate a scenario where you do that for me. So the more authentic we can be with our needs and the better we can be at meeting those needs directly, the more authentic we will become as well.
That makes sense. Oh, yeah. It makes sense. And I definitely feel that's definitely a new awareness, which a lot of people will embrace once they really realize the benefits of it. Because really out here, we manipulate people in relationships, for example, through games.
Yes.
You see, because we really want their attention. We're
badly.
Just afraid to say it.
Yeah.
So sometimes we do things, And because we know if we're going to be authentic, they probably won't talk to us.
Oh, yeah.
You see, so sometimes it's no wonder why a lot of people who... Sometimes people can overact or be super emotional just to get what they want. And it works, but at the same time, how do you feel afterwards? I always tell that to people. You always feel better when you do it on your terms. Just like Sinatra said, I did it my way. That's the ultimate freedom. And I feel when people... Sometimes you have to feel the burn. You have to... If you're in a relationship, for example, and you say something to your partner and they don't give you the response you want, we say, okay, let me say something else, even though it's not what you want to say. What about no? What about just sticking to what you said to begin with and feeling like, gosh, I know my partner is not going to like this. But when you can do that, it's a lot easier to come to really allow and accept yourself. When you change, like I used to do this all the time when I used to make YouTube videos, I would do a title and realize, okay, it wasn't getting 301, right? So I would say, oh, let me change the title. And I was like, wait a minute, let me just let it burn. And then all of a sudden, I even stopped watching it altogether. Views, likes.
That's good.
It wasn't of any concern to me because once again, that's not where my value was. That's not where my power was. You see, so I always tell people, really go through the feeling.
Yes.
Don't try and change the feeling. Go yes. through the feeling. You don't have to change who you are. You have to accept who you are.
Exactly. That's total authenticity. So how do you feel about all this lovely relationship advice out there? I got to tell you, it's like it makes my blood boil. Do you know how many of these things people send me of like 12 ways to ensure your man's never going to lose you or leave you, or, you know, how to behave on a first date? It's like I literally get to the point where I can feel myself seething at the fact that the common... idea essentially is that unless you alter yourself, that somebody's going to reject you. It's so sad to me.
Right. Well, I give a lot of information out and I always tell people really and truly, there is no manual for life. You weren't born with a manual for a reason. You see, there's a reason why you weren't born with an instruction kit, because you have to figure this out. And every single, it's almost like, I love one video you made, I think a year ago or two, where you were like, okay, take bits of different religions, beliefs, cultures, and then put it in a pot and then create your own. Because yep. That's really how a relationship is. You can read 100 books on the best relationship, but once again, there are variables. Everything is so dynamic and fluid. Mm. And once again, nothing is set in stone. And when you realize that, you realize to allow the ebb and flow of life, really and truly, you have to realize that. It doesn't, some people, they spend their whole life with someone, they've grown up together, and then one day they say, actually, I don't want to be with you. What? Because once again, that's the nature of the universe. The universe is all about unpredictability. It's all about the unknown and exploring new possibilities. You see, the universe hates structure. The universe hates structure. We're trying to find structure. Help us out here. You see, the universe is always trying to create something which is original. And many people in relationships, it becomes a routine. See, they don't have a relationship, they have a routine.
Yes.
Problem with a routine is that it becomes predictable. The problem with predictability is that now there's no growth.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens when you first meet each other? The first moment you set eyes on your loved one, wow, they're fireworks. Flowers are blooming all over the place because there is growth.
Mm-hmm.
There is growth because it's the unknown. There is unpredictability. Nobody knows what's going to happen. That's what makes it so exciting, so exhilarating, and so fun. That's why you connect on a whole nother level when you first meet.
Yes.
And you can do that when you're in a relationship, but once again, you have to lose the routine.
Oh, and also I want people, when they're in relationships, to remind themselves that you will never know who somebody is. Every human being on this earth is like a universe unto themselves with the same unpredictability, variability. So if you think you know your loved one, you're mistaken.
Well, it happened to me along my journey. I was with someone and all of a sudden one day, we had parted ways, but they just changed their whole behavior. I said, what? You aren't the person I remembered you to be.
Yep.
But once again, I always say they don't have to be. That's what I realized just from studying nature. Also, I'm a big fan of your artwork. You see, if you're an artist, you realize that you have to allow colors to take their own form and shape.
Yes.
Without trying to govern them.
And they have authenticity, so they're not worried about taking their own shape, are they?
Right. That's the most wonderful thing, you see. But once again, we're only worried about someone else's authenticity when we're out of our own authenticity.
Exactly. That should be your new quote, by the way.
Right, okay. We're only worried about someone else's authenticity when we are out of our own authenticity.
Freaking perfect.
Right. I'll put it on Instagram.
Bow. A bow gets tied around that one. That was beautiful. So the way that I wanted to sum up, I wanted to sort of bring this talk of ours to a close by demonstrating the power of the perfect question. Because I think that when it comes to authenticity, if we really are wanting to commit to that, we have to be willing to ask ourselves and question ourselves all day, every day. And we have to understand it's different than doubt. Doubt, actually, when you're in a state of doubt, you've already made your mind up about yourself. That's not a state of questioning. We have to stay open and curious to the idea that something could be completely different than what we think. So never underestimate the power of a good question when it comes to knowing yourself. And knowing yourself is really the platform, I guess, upon which all authenticity is standing. So what you can do, essentially, is hang around people who are going to ask you good questions. Go looking for good questions. That's another thing that I would also say. So I've collected an example. They're not like anything spectacular, but I've collected some, and I figured that you and I could set the bar by answering them. Yeah?
Let's go.
All right. One, if you had all the money in the world, meaning that you didn't like have to work for anything, what would you be doing? Or what could you not stop doing?
Skating. I love skating. I'm skating every day. I'll always be skating. It doesn't matter if I have 100 million or nothing.
That's wonderful.
And
my,
you?
My answer is writing. But like I like to write philosophy, honestly. I like to basically reflect upon the world and my experience. So I'm never going to stop writing about myself, and I'm never going to stop writing about the world. And I came
across your blog, and I'm like, that could be turned into a book. Do you know that? You're writing like essays and what most people would put into a book. You're just giving it freely away. I'm saying that's incredible, but then I know it's part of your gift. It's effortless.
Yes, it is. It's like more effortless than anything else in my life. And I love it.
Amazing.
Okay, so what activity lights you up with joy besides skating?
I love sharing videos. I'm naturally a communicator. I've always been one with a big mouth. But not in the sense where I just like to yell at people. But really, I love to talk. I just love to talk. And it's not what I'm saying that really motivates me. It's dancing around with the energy of the words. I can do that all day. That's why a lot of people, sometimes I put out video after video, because I just get in the creative flow of just doing this dance, you see. And you?
Skiing.
Wow.
I love skiing. It's just amazing. I also love being around horses. I don't even need to be on top of them, but just like being around them is amazing. I love all of that. All right, what are you the most afraid of?
Well, for me, I'm afraid of... I would think it would be... That's a hard question. I would think, like, because it keeps changing with me. Right now, what I'm most afraid of would be really the fear of losing it all, you see. And that's why every day I'm learning more to let go. Losing it all in the sense of if the computer crashes all one day and I lose everything, how do you go back and build yourself up? But once again, I'm realizing, okay, I've got this. But also as well, my great fear is to become greedy. Even though I'm in my authenticity and my passion, I don't want to become greedy in my authenticity, if that makes sense. I want to be able to still have, you know, I already have relationships, but even more authentic ones. You see, I always feel, for me, that's really a great gift. But at the same time, I fear sometimes I can almost get lost in the whirlwind of creation.
Me too.
You see, and sometimes my fear is that I go too far. But I just have fun most times. And you?
I think my number one fear is insignificance. It's right. Basically, it's like I feel like insignificance to me is the opposite of excellence. It's almost like being so not good enough that you're forsaken.
Right.
So it's like, it's more than loneliness to me. It's like you've been flat out rejected because of the state of not good enough that you're in, you know? Yeah, that's by far my number one fear. Okay, looking at my life, what is my actual priority?
To become my greatest version and to help other people become their greatest versions. And to have fun, yeah.
See, you ready for this? So right now, this is an opportunity for inauthenticity. Because when I hear you say that word, it makes me feel like, oh, mine should be more like that. Because that answer that you gave is very much more what we would expect a spiritual teacher to be saying. What I think I should say. So basically right now there's a temptation to be like, oh yes, definitely, always growth and progression is my goal. But if you want me to tell you the honest truth, like when I look at my life and my actual priority, it's excellence. I want to be the best.
Right. So you want to be the best, but I talk about becoming your greatest version.
Well, yeah, and that's awesome.
Right. That's so awesome. Do you find being excellent, do you find, for instance, like you make videos on YouTube. Do you ever feel like you have to compete with someone else on YouTube?
Yes.
Who?
Everyone.
Okay. So, because do you,
I'm right, just being right. Super authentic. Like this is a shadow that I'm very aware of in myself because I was a competitive athlete before I did this job. And so it's like, I have to watch, you know, what it is that it's because of my fear. Did you see what I'm most afraid of translate directly to what my priority is.
Right.
So being aware of that is really important, you know?
Can you own that competitiveness? Because what I've seen is that...
Look at me.
Right.
I'm doing it right now.
Right. That's amazing.
But
even turn it into almost like a pro. Say, actually, it's actually a great gift to be competitive. A lot of people don't realize one of the greatest gifts to be competitive is because you spur each other on.
I know.
Some of your videos I watch, I'm like, damn. You see? Because you actually... You probably don't know this, but you actually inspired me to create a video called How to Decalcify Your Pineal Gland.
Awesome.
Right, because I saw your video on the third eye, and I'm like, wow, I'm inspired. So it was the competitiveness turned into a more inspiration. Say, actually, okay, she thinks she's all this. Let me show you what I've got. But it was almost like a game, you know, like a fun, like a playing, and I feel... We become our best when we can actually... That's why I always say, once you start collaborating with people, it's amazing because you start creating this friendly competition where it becomes a point where you don't even really fear what the other person is doing. You just look to them for a source of inspiration.
Oh, and works.
Now it works, definitely.
I did a video called Exaltation, and it was about this, where you basically take the trait that is not good about you, essentially, according to your own judgment, and you basically figure out what the highest and best version of that thing is instead of eradicating it. And competition was definitely mine. And I've gotten to a point in my life, because I'm so aware of my competitive edge, that it's like my favorite thing in the world is to play with the players that are the best. It's sort of like you're not going to become an NBA All-Star by playing people who are on a farm team. It's not going to work. You have to play with the best of the best. You have to keep setting that bar higher and higher. And doing that, the beauty in doing that, it's not about being better than other people. What it is that like every time that bar goes up, you actually get to discover a whole new dimension of your own capability. And I am addicted to that. I love that.
Definitely.
Next question. What legacy do you want to leave behind and why?
The legacy really is just to... that being free is your birthright. And the reason why is because when people are more free, they become more dangerous. When you're more dangerous, once again, you get to explore unseen realms and places you never thought you could ever go to.
I love that.
And you?
The legacy that I want to leave behind is a positive world change legacy. It's like I want the eradication of suffering. Now that word eradication is very harsh and very like striking. So obviously I don't like the idea of cutting something out, but I want to leave behind a legacy of positive world change, and I mean on a real tangible level. So I want to change institutions. I want to change the way that our society runs, and I want to die and know that that's what I've left behind is that the actual that shift, basically.
Well, let me tell you, you've already done it. You see, we are living in a time. I was speaking to someone about this the other day. That, do you know, you've connected with so many millions of people. So have I. This is unheard of in centuries before. Even people who were authors, they could probably only reach their local village.
Yep.
Right?
Yeah.
So a lot of the times we don't even realize that we are the living legacy. And because of that, once again, it goes back into realizing how much you've done, that you, how much you already are a living legend, and write it down. I'm a living legend. Don't be humble about it. Say it, because it's the truth. And then you start entering new territory.
That's a good one.
Right.
Okay, there are only two more questions, I swear.
Ready? Let's go.
Isn't this fun? What am I the most afraid people will see about me?
Wow. Well, bringing up my whole past. You see, sometimes a lot of people love to dig deep. I've already had a video made about me. And a lot of the times I don't really place a lot of attention. I actually watched it because, for me, sometimes I might watch something because just to lose the fear. Once again, if I'm afraid of something, I give it power. So I'm just like a fan. I'm watching popcorn. Oh, what is he saying about Ralph Smart? I say, oh, this is interesting. Oh, really? I didn't even know that. You see? So a lot of the times, sometimes that's a fear. Always, not really from other people, but from those closest to you. You see, because sometimes, for instance, it's those closest to you that can hurt you the most. Yes. I don't really care about other people I connect with who say stuff about me, even people that watch my videos so much. That doesn't affect me, but it's people who you've grown up with, certain times, family members, you know, and it's that fear of abandonment. But I've always had support. But once again, it always lingers on, you know, in the back of my mind that, for instance, you share with the world, if you're in a relationship, I've been in a great relationship, but at the same time, you have to really be with someone that supports you. Otherwise, it can turn into a form of jealousy. You see, it can turn into a form of, okay, you're prioritizing. I'm like, I'm totally not, baby. But once again, it can turn into that. So that's always the fear, like you don't become, once again, too in your own creation, that people start saying, actually, now you're just ignoring me. So for me, I'm always saying, okay, I don't want to just, you know, be solely on me. I want to always give back to someone else. And I hope I don't, you know, just stay. Yeah. And you?
I think I'm the most afraid that people, you know, what's interesting is I feel like the thing I'm the most afraid of is actually what I want the most. I'm afraid
what
that
you
people,
want?
I'm afraid that people will see my pain. Because basically, you know, when I'm in the position where I am, I've got amazing information when it comes to being happy, but there's also a big aspect of me that is not happy. And it's like, I, you know, if people see that, I am really desperately afraid that they're just going to write off all of my information and everything that I create, and I'll go down into that insignificance category, basically. But it's also something that I want people to see, because I've spent my life pulling in the opposite direction of it, and there's a part of me that wants to know that people can be present with my pain as well. Interesting, right?
That's wonderful.
Okay, next one. How would you like other people to perceive you? Now, before I go into this one, this question, by the way, some of you should answer these questions at home too that we've been asking. I've noticed that this particular question alerts you to your biggest insecurities and your biggest inauthenticities, because basically how you want other people to perceive you is your biggest facade. So the lies that you've been telling yourself, essentially, Most of them will fall under this particular question. So, how would you like other people to perceive you?
Well, for me, it's really as a very free spirit. You see, that's how I perceive myself. I always remind people, I'm not what you think I am. And I do that by putting things like, can I get a hello there? I'm trying to show you I'm very weird. I'm trying to show you my weirdness. Please don't follow me. And for me, it's really, it's about showing people I'm not always smiling, you see? And sometimes I feel people should I don't really want to control how people perceive me anyway. That's what people's, once again, I don't really think of a lot of people. I'm really focused on how I perceive myself, because I always say the perception you have of yourself is greater than the perception other people have of you. As long as you focus on your own perception, don't worry about it. I think there was that fashion designer who said, you're thinking about me, but I'm not thinking about you. You see, and it's that whole thing going on where I feel that a lot of people always say, oh, Ralph, you're so positive, you're so smiling all the time. And I suppose that's wonderful when people perceive you like that, because I always know happiness is the highest frequency.
I perceive you that way.
right. You see, and for me, sometimes, you know, it's like that's why I always have a lot of respect for these, even people like yourself and people like Buddha and all of these amazing spirits who really share with the world, even though they know it's not 100% perfect. You're trying to tell people, it's like on the Titanic, you know, we're almost like the people playing the violin, you know, when the boat is going down, you know, we're trying to make everybody happy. And sometimes, but at the same time, we also know that we're not on the Titanic. That's the whole point. We're far from those circumstances. We're living in the most amazing time right now on the planet. A time just like what you are all about, a time for positive change. So we already know what the world can become. That's why we're doing what we're doing. We wouldn't do it if we didn't realize the possibility to create a whole new world.
That's good.
And you?
I think the two things that I'm the most interested in people perceiving in me is first and foremost excellence, and second, virtue. Now, what's really interesting is if we study the personality spectrum, personality is really set up as a result of our overcompensations for traits that we felt like we didn't have enough of. And it can be very small interactions that lead to this. So the story that I like telling the most about my own personality is that, you know, when I was very young, I remember a scenario when I was 2 years old. I had thrown myself on the floor in a fit, and my mother essentially had looked at me and she said, "Why can't you just be nice?" Now, that's a typical thing for a mom to basically say to a kid who's throwing a fit, right? But in my little mind, I basically made that mean that I have no virtue, no goodness innately. And so the way that I compensated for that was to immediately go outside, and I started doing gymnastics routines. Like jumping, you know, it was the performance. If I have a level of excellence, now that makes up for my lack of virtue. So a lot of my inauthenticities where I can't admit to things, or like when I say yes when I really mean no, that's the wanting people to perceive me as virtuous. A lot of those inauthenticities in my life revolve around those two central themes, you'll notice. And it's like interesting because I want people to see in me the thing I feel like I lack, and I want them desperately to see the thing that I know is my, you know, greatest overcompensation for that perceived lack, which is excellence. Yeah.
Excellence. Tell me about excellence. Really. It's so amazing how the whole world wants us to be excellent. And I feel that sometimes stems from us trying to become excellent. And sometimes I always listen to different music. And sometimes you've got people who are so, they literally are really vulnerable to the extent where they just tell the world how horrible they are and how many women they're sleeping with or how many men they're sleeping with. They basically literally tell them, like, I'm a bad role model. And I sometimes think to myself, have we got it all wrong? Are we supposed to be doing that as well? To really owning how literally we're just like them on a different, you know, a different kind of, you know, in a different suit.
I think we should be doing both.
We should definitely be doing both, but I feel, especially in this community, it's so shunned upon to go outside and do anything like that. For instance, if you're really like, for instance, if you were to talk about someone that you don't like, that's what we all naturally judge people. So why are we trying to show the world like we don't judge anyone? And why are we trying to tell the world that we shouldn't judge anyone when we all do it?
Yeah.
So that's what I've had to check myself about and realize that that's really absurd. You see, because we all love a bit of gossip here and there. We all love a bit of celebrity gossip. Nothing wrong with it. I do. So why can't we admit it?
Yeah.
And that's why, you know, I feel it's amazing when you can really move in different directions.
Yes. And admitting it is everything, because then you admit to where you are. And if you, and the second that you know where you are, you finally have a platform from which to get to where you want to be in life. It's
right.
Like instant.
Well, what's helped me, and I feel you can probably relate to this, is that, you see, I always tell people I'm not a teacher. I'm a student and a teacher. Therefore, that means that being a student, I have a lot to learn as well, but also I have a lot to share. And that's why sometimes I talk about different stuff, which is, you know, news topics and stuff, because I'm also interested. I'm also interested how other people perceive it. But you can only do that when you take off your robes and actually say, actually, I'm interested in this news story. Let me share my view. And you find a lot of people are also interested. And that's how you create more authentic connections. You know, it's like people who say, yeah, you know, well, the post didn't come today. And you're like, oh my gosh, the post didn't come today, because you actually feel like you know who these people are. That in itself is more powerful than them telling you to go and do what, go and eat this kind of food or go and live your life like this. You're like, get out of here. I don't even know who you are because I haven't connected to you on a human level.
Yes.
You've got to connect with people on a human level first before you begin opening your mouth to anything, especially advice. That's what I've learned.
It's a good lesson. The other thing I would encourage people to do relative to authenticity is you got to see the impact of the inauthenticity. So in my case, a lot of the... So let's go back to the overcompensation, the personality aspects. Let's pretend that I see that basically I want people to see my excellence so bad that I potentially hide the aspects of me that I believe are not excellent. I've made a practice of trying not to hide those now, by the way. But before, when I was in a much less authentic mode, I had to admit to myself, basically, the sheer exhaustion involved in having to basically pull myself up by the bootstraps and go into a state of excellence, even though something really tragic had happened about 10 minutes earlier. It's an exhausting state of being to be, and it's also very lonely because there's no one that's going to relate to you when you're the top of the pyramid. So,
definitely.
So I would have people really look for the impact of the inauthenticity in your life, and especially look in the sector of relationships, because if you're inauthentic, you can't really have intimacy with another person.
That's one for me. That's what I've got to learn more of. And I feel that's what so many people can benefit from, because so many of us, everyone, especially in relationships, is striving for excellence. What a lot of people forget is that you have to work together in excellence. What happens is a lot of people, they're so excellent, the other person is so excellent, that they drift apart in their own excellence and they become separate. What about if both of you work together in this excellence? And say, actually, make a joint commitment to say, okay, we're going to work together to become excellent. What happens is a lot of people, they go off in their own ventures, and now sometimes it's like a game. Certain people feel left out because they see the other person becoming more excellent than they are. But what about if you both were conscious about, we can never become more excellent than each other because we're working together in excellence. My excellence is your excellence.
That's sharing. That's true sharing, yeah.
You see? How can your partner be your competition and someone you're trying to go against?
Very easily in today's world.
Very easily, because once again, it's a whole thing where everybody, no one wants to have the traditional role society has placed on them. You've got people who are working in a cafe and they're like, what? I just want to do selfies on Instagram and get paid for it. I don't blame you. Go for it. You see, that's the kind of world we're living in. We're living in the world of the dream chasers. And the world of the dream chasers is that it's wonderful, but in chasing your dream, you have to realize that it's a lot of sacrifice. Once again, you might lose people who were really authentic and genuine people. You got to be careful. That's what I've learned, that you don't want to be running so fast that you lose track of what's right in front of you. That could be the real dream right there. We're trying to climb the mountain and get to the top, but maybe the real secret is at the bottom and just going in the gentle flow of the process. The process is the destination.
That's true, yes. Now, remembering that when you're in the middle of it is a lot.
No. You see, well, that's how it all works. It's always easy to say it. But it's like when you're on stage, just like acting, or even when you're drawing, there's no time to start analyzing stuff. You're in the most authentic space when you're... And have you ever thought of sharing your artwork, like doing tutorials and stuff to show the world how amazing your art is, and also realizing that could also benefit people just as much as you're sharing and stuff?
No, I've never thought of it.
That's powerful, because I see your art, and in fact, when I was in Venice, California, there was a kind of sacred geometry, and it just reminded me. I said, "Oh, that's teal," but it's not teal's work. See, your work is very distinctive, very unique, very authentic, and I always feel that. Like, I put out songs on my channel just to mix it up a bit, you know, because I also record and I'm a musician. So for me, it's always wonderful because it takes the pressure off. You see, I think a lot of us, we're suffering right now. We talk about suffering because we only want to show the world one aspect of ourselves. Yep. So we have to maintain this facade,
yes.
Which we know that's not even us, because after we finish doing it, we're doing something else.
Yeah. Oh, and then people get very disillusioned when they hang out with you. That was a shock right. to me, actually. Well, you know, when they'd come in and I'm frustrated about something, they're like, wait a minute, this is Teal Swan. She shouldn't be frustrated about anything. I thought she was in such a high state. And I was like, oh, I have to show this also. Hell yeah. The majority of our suffering is because we only want people to see one aspect. And then it's hell on earth, because why? We're left by ourselves with the other aspects of ourselves. That's true loneliness, if you really want to know.
Wow. You know, I'm learning already so much from this interview, because this conversation, this dialogue, this friendship, this connection, because it's all part of it. And when we all realize that, you've said it right there, we have to show the world what we're afraid to show them.
Exactly.
So this what we want to show them, that's the easy part. You got to do what you're afraid of. What's really uncomfortable, now it becomes your comfort when you can exercise it.
And that is the freest thing. I think you want to talk about freedom. So we're coming back to your theme, okay? Personal
right,
freedom.
Right.
There is nothing on this earth that I have done more liberating than that. Nothing. When I put it all out there, when I literally, like, called it, I aired my dirty laundry, essentially, and I realized that what came back to me was not going to kill me, that was the biggest freedom I have ever experienced on this earth to date.
Right. That's wonderful. And how do you deal with people's interpretation of you as this ascended master?
I don't.
You don't. But what happens when... Sometimes, for instance, many people are asking you for advice and you don't have the answer. Do you give them an answer, or do you say, I don't know, and then move along?
I'll say, I don't know.
Right. Because I've seen that's what you've done. And it's so authentic. That's what I do as well a lot of the times these days. And what advice would you give to someone, a really young guy or girl who's just coming up in this Instagram world of likes? The reason why I'm mentioning likes is because likes, we're talking about love here. You see, like is the closest thing to love. So when people in this social media world, they get a video with 1 million views, that translates into love.
Mm-hmm.
If they get an Instagram post with 10 likes, that translates into feeling not worthy. So what do you say to someone who may not be getting any attention, but they really want it in a social media setting, like videos on YouTube or on Facebook, and literally no one caring about what they're doing.
Well, I would always take them into trauma work, because I've noticed that because of the law of mirroring in this universe, there's nobody that's getting no attention that doesn't have a primary wound of feeling invisible and ignored. So instead of going in the direction of finding love in and of themselves and everything, I would take them in the entire opposite direction and drop them as deep into that feeling of invisibility as they possibly can. And we'd essentially resolve the primary wound that has caused that condition, which is now just mirroring in their adult life.
Wow. And what's next for Teal Swan? That's what people... You've dropped the book Shadows Before Dawn, which is phenomenal. Do you feel... You've spoken about self-love. Do you feel that really is the secret as well to moving closer to your authenticity? Is that right? Why you wrote the book?
Well, let me put it this way. If you don't air your dirty laundry, then you're in rejection of some aspect of yourself. So it goes hand in hand. And so, yeah, I feel like authenticity is a huge part of self-love. But
because I feel with authenticity, it even goes so intricately into what we do every single day, our 9 to 5. And I feel a lot of people who are on their way to being authentic, we said it, you have to, you know, have your own business, but as well, you have to really have freedom of speech.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I get offers all the time. You probably do as well, for like companies for you to endorse a product or something. And
yes.
Sometimes you're like, should I do that? And you often find that if you do it, you're going to go down a long and winding road, and it's just going to lead into you becoming a kind of something totally different from what you started out to be.
Yeah, that's what selling out is all about. That's exactly what selling out is all about. And I got to tell you, it's tempting. It's real tempting when they've got all the money there too, to say, you know what, my freedom, that's the priority thing. Is that more important than my freedom of speech? Now, for some people, they might answer yes. I'm not in a place where I like to judge whether like it's always right for someone to refuse that. But basically, I've been put in that position multiple times where it's like, which one is more important to you? It's almost like the universe is kind of testing me. How much do you care about this? And I like to remind myself that basically there is not a revolutionary on the planet Earth who has not been tested in their adherence to their own beliefs and their own priorities. So...
Right. And do you have a fear of getting so you're already massive, but even... getting to the point where people can bring up dirty laundry with a lot of evidence,
no.
Which might be, you know, swaying other people to form an opinion of you, which they might not have never seen, and start talking and stuff.
Oh, they're doing a lot of that right now. No, because I know it's inevitable. And
right.
One of the good parts about knowing that something is inevitable is that you can release resistance to it. It's almost like saying, well, there's nothing I can do about this. That can either push you into powerlessness or an empowerment of saying, if there's nothing I can do about it, then what do I have control over? I have no control over how people talk about me. I'm never going to be able to change a lot of their minds. Believe me, I've freaking tried. So basically, once you're at that point
right.
where you're not going to change their mind, what's left? What's left is I got to do the thing I can't stop doing, even if I had all the money in the world, which is what I'm doing. So... there I go.
Right.
But it doesn't feel good. That's what people have to get. It's not like I'm like, oh, yay, people freaking hate me and want, like, you know, and think I'm the Antichrist. That doesn't make me feel good. It makes me feel like crap. But it's also, like, nothing I can do about it, A. And B, it's an opportunity for me to go into the wounds within, because that wouldn't be reflecting if I was in complete harmony with myself. I wouldn't be a match to even seeing it. So.
Right. But I feel a lot of people, and I always tell a lot of people, you probably get this, how can I start making YouTube videos and get on a level where you have a lot of people connecting with you? And I always...
Really? You get that a lot? I've never had that question once.
You never? Okay. Well, a lot of people say they want to start sharing their message with the world.
Okay, yeah. Well, that too. I do get that.
You see, and a lot of people, they find getting a lot of resistance, you know, from people when they voice their opinions. And I always say, that's what it's like. Again, we're gladiators out here. You've got to realize you've got to become a gladiator and you've got to deal with it. You see, and you have to also realize that eventually you become friends with a lion when you realize the lion is yourself.
That and like, are you, that's a good one. I like that. You become, I like that. That's epic. I was like, wait a minute. He just dropped it like it's hot.
Drop it like it's hot, baby. Yeah.
Yeah, I love that. That was really beautiful. We also have to ask ourselves whether we're going to commit to playing on the court, because basically, if you... if you listen to the conversations that are going on in the stands, they're all the same. It's all criticism. It always was. Of any basketball game, football game, it's all just criticism. Right? Or judgments about the play. So the question is, do you want to spend your life in the stands? Which really wasn't an option if you came here, you're playing. But let's just pretend you're either committed to the game or you're not. Or are you going to be down on the field? Just say, you know what, regardless of their judgment or not judgment, who's the one playing the game? Is it me or them? And based on playing the game, whose life is going to be much more worth living?
That's so powerful. Did you hear about the free nipple? There was this massive campaign about free the nipple. Have you heard about anything about that?
Is this like the La Leche League stuff? Like the breastfeeding stuff?
Yeah, because a lot of women, there's this massive viral campaign. It's like a hashtag, and it's like women who are just basically going topless and stuff, especially in San Diego. And it's like they're really trying to push it. And it's so liberating just to see so many women just go topless in the most empowering way. I mean, how more authentic can you get?
I love that. So basically, I live in a very conservative state. Where breastfeeding is like a really big issue, and even though it's like federally they cannot require you if you're in a public place to cover up, right? But people would come up to me all the time and be like, I don't think it's okay that you're breastfeeding in front of people, and I would get really upset about it. So like, I'm actually one of those people who's on the train with the whole La Leche League thing about, like, I mean, we have to really stand up for that kind of a cause and say, no, I'm unwilling to be completely, I mean, this is ridiculous, you know? It's right. Ridiculous.
And how important, because I always say, a question for you, when you share with the world, when you're in your workshops and what have you, I always see you have a sense of humor. You love to laugh in between when you're talking. How important is humor when you're really diving deep and whenever you're doing shadow work? Do you have to have a sense of humor, or can you go in stone face in terms of, is there a reason why a lot of children are smiling? Not just one child. This is a natural phenomenon where you have millions of children laughing and babies giggling, and they do this naturally, more so than any other emotion. They're smiling, and they would rather be giggling and playing with something than being in a state of total despair. They gravitate to what feels good.
Laughter is a discharge of positive emotion, and so it's a natural byproduct of being completely in alignment. As you grow up, you think thoughts that pull you out of alignment with your being, and thus that natural flow, it's not an excess of energy, and so there's no reason for the discharge. Essentially, you have to look for a reason for that discharge to occur. So children don't have to look for that reason because of their focus. But so when I would say that basically it's not necessary to do shadow work, but it's like going down in a dark hole with an even better flashlight. If you have a sense of humor while you're doing shadow work, the shadows are just, I mean, it's 10 times easier to illuminate them. It's 10 times easier to turn those shadows into light.
Right. And what would you say keeps people, human beings, away from each other? Is it really the ego? For instance, grudges. For instance, a lot of people, they've had a friend and they don't even know why they're not talking to each other anymore. They've been in a relationship and they don't even know why they're not talking. It just ended suddenly on a Friday night after something happened, and then, you know, days become months, months become years. If ego wasn't there, would people who really want to naturally gravitate towards each other naturally gravitate towards each other?
Hell yes, because there would be no fear of vulnerability. The ego is concerned with survival, and vulnerability equates to like death to the ego. And so the second that you decide that that's an important priority, which you pretty much have if you come into a human life, you're not going to be the one that wants to do that, that's going to want to be vulnerable. It has to be a conscious thing. Our unconscious mind is going to prioritize survival. The conscious mind is the one that can say, you know what, I can feel this vulnerability and I'm going forward anyways, basically. So we can make up for this thing that has happened with us separating from each other by being the one who's willing to be the first vulnerable one. The one who's willing to say, look, I don't know why this happened, but I really want to have the relationship back. Or, you know, fill in the blank, whatever. That's scary, because we could meet with rejection. Rejection is like annihilation, right?
You could meet with silence, utter silence, which is terrifying, right? Yeah.
But that's why I feel like commitment to authenticity is everything, because because then the conversation is occurring not necessarily because you want an end result. It's occurring because of the fact that you have made a commitment to authenticity and how good authenticity feels. So even if it's not, if it's met with silence on the other end, right, it's about me saying what I need to have said so that I feel a state of completion.
Right.
Will definitely. I ever get over it if I don't say this thing? I mean, do you know how many people I sit with people who die a lot in my career, in my profession. And what you hear the most is regrets. That is a state of incompletion. What that is that person never did contact their first love to see where they were. That person never did bury the hatchet between themselves and somebody they wanted to bury the hatchet with, but were too afraid they were going to be met with rejection about. So I feel like we need to live our lives for that, not for the reaction, but for a state of completion with ourselves all the time. So we have to stop living with that discomfort and actually face it and do something about it, which we can do by being authentic. Whether you write me back or not, I said it. So I did everything I could do. And that is what enables me to basically die a happy person.
Or at least a video right there.
Yep.
That's a video right there. That's going to help a hell of a lot of people, because I feel that's what I call it, foolish pride. Foolish pride is saying, actually, well, I'm independent. I don't need anybody because I'm feeling good. But deep down, we know we've got unfinished business. I call it unfinished business, where it's the ego is trying to hold on. It's trying to hold on just to be this super so-called powerful person. But deep down, the heart is saying, drop it. Come on, drop it and let go of this foolish pride. And now you can sleep at night when you've let go of everything on your chest. You've gotten what you want to say off, and now you can just sleep peacefully.
Exactly.
Instead of pretending everything is kosher and everything is all good.
Perfect. So do you have any closing words for our conversation today?
Yeah. I would just say, really, own your weirdness. The last time it was love yourself 100%. This time it's own your weirdness. And you're going to meet a lot of other weird people. And you're not even going to think what they're doing is weird. How weird is that? That's it. And you?
My closing statement would be very simple. Air your dirty laundry. It's the best thing you could ever do for your life. And I've already done it. So I'm like actual living proof of the fact that if you air your dirty laundry, nothing really happens. You don't spontaneously combust.
Right. And but you laundry is always building up. Can you air your dirty laundry, or do you have to keep airing your dirty laundry?
You have to keep doing it. You keep calling the ego out. You make it your personal practice. And you know what? You will make the best friends you've ever made in your life. It's amazing.
Right. I mean, I've seen, like, some of the videos you do. I'm like, how? Because you really, you dive so deep. I dive deep. You dive super deep into areas like, of course, you've made your super popular videos. But you talk of videos like transgender, cutting, and all of these topics which are so fringe, which, like, wow. But I know because of that you are meeting the most amazing people in the world.
I am, yes.
And you're having the most amazing connections because you really dive into areas everyone's afraid of touching, because once again, by going into that area, you're gonna have to reveal certain things about your character. It's like if you made a video on Bruce Jenner or Caitlyn Jenner, once again, people are gonna know where you stand. And that's what a lot of us are holding back. Sometimes I even have to check myself out. That's why, you know, I did a video on the Charleston shooting so people could know what I think of that. Because once again, once you air what you think, it's not easy because you're going to create a divide.
Yep.
You know, I said I don't believe in race, but some people might believe in race. So it's just wonderful, though, because once again, what I say, you trim down, which is fantastic for the trees.
So do you have anything fun coming up that you want people to know about? Any new books or like seminars or things you're doing?
Definitely. Well, for me, it's really about collaboration. I feel this is all about, that's the next level for me. I've done a lot of videos. I will always be doing videos every day. But the next step is to really collaborate and also to lose that program like we've done anything. Like I was telling about my mentor, Omran Mikhail Ivanov, he actually never wrote any books. He would do a talk in Bulgaria, and he's got so many different books on the most amazing stuff. And he's not in a judgmental way, but it just, you know, he always used to say, never rest on your laurels, you know. So for me, that's why I share, because I've realized the trap. Whenever you get stuck on anything, you're in big trouble. You're in big trouble. I'm moving so fast, I don't even have time to look what I did yesterday. People are going to remind me, oh, you did a video. And I say, really? I say, I didn't know. You know, so for me, it's just about more collaboration with you. You know, who is the most amazing being in the world? You know, I consider you like a reflection. And I feel that if we can really authentically share more and show the world unity. You see, suffering is only created through isolation. What would happen when people could see other people who are talking about so-called connection actually connecting with other people who are talking about the same thing?
Yes.
Do you know, imagine, it's so powerful. Imagine if Buddha and Jesus came together, right? All of that is synthesis. Synthesis is what, right? It's that whole amazing connection. And for me, that's really what I'm pushing forward.
I see a lot of that in your future.
Right. And yours too, because I just see that we're all creating so many spider webs.
Yep.
We can only create spider webs by, once again, airing our dirty laundry.
Yes.
By going into new frontiers, boldly going where no one has gone before. And to do that, once again, you have to realize there's going to be a hell of a lot of resistance. You know, I sometimes look at the vegan community. I'm a vegan.
Me too.
But sometimes, you know, they say stuff like people shouldn't eat meat. And some of them are really out there. But once again, they create the buzz because they're so authentic. They're so passionate that you can't help but listen.
Uh-huh.
Even if you don't agree with them. And a lot of people may not like it, but once again, they get the message out.
Yes, totally.
But once again, they're airing the dirty laundry of what they really think. Instead of saying, actually, well, I think everybody should eat what they want because we all should. No, actually, I don't. I think it's terrible. I think it's absolutely atrocious that human beings kill animals. I mean, that's what I really think.
Me too. Me too.
You know?
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's all a matter of, like, when you're driving, how much of the accelerator, how much of the gas do you want to press? I mean, some people just drive up to 180. Some people drive at a 60, you know. Some people drive at a moderate 40, which is perfectly fine. But, you know, have no guilt of going up to the full speed, you know, and saying deal with it. You know, there was actually a guy who had these sunglasses and he said deal with it. you know, deal with it, because it's not about, you know, in spirituality and even becoming your greatest version, we always talk of compassion. You know, Dalai Lama, you know, people look to these people because they have compassion, which I think really, that is really the most powerful thing, because I always say, you can't help people if you hurt people. You can't shout at someone. You might get their attention, but you won't win their heart. Right? And we only are really moved by people when they touch us on the heart level. And that's why you had oracles, because they never told you what to do. They would almost be like healers. So people, generals, would tell them all of their stories, their most intimate secrets, because they weren't threatening. They were so vulnerable that, like you know, you're so vulnerable, I'm so vulnerable, that people tell you things like, wow, I didn't want you to tell me your whole life story. But people feel so free to express because they know that you're not going to judge them.
Exactly. Because I'm going to throw myself onto the table too.
Right. Right.
And we have to know that about authenticity. Basically, when you're authentic, that authentic truth doesn't necessarily hurt. We've been telling ourselves the lie that the truth always hurts or whatever. What I have noticed in my own life is when I'm genuinely authentic, which means I'm going to basically say whatever I'm the most vulnerable about, it doesn't hurt people. It liberates people. Even if it's what we would consider to be, on an intellectual level, an unsavory truth.
Right, right. Well, I always feel like it's amazing to, sometimes, you know, I've got my mom and my sister, they watch my videos, they love it, but I always say, should I really bring them into my videos? Does the world need to see everything? I mean, that's what I'm kind of dealing with at the moment. Like, I could show the world, but I always say, Do I feel like it? You see what I'm trying to say? And I always say, do what you feel like. Yes. Don't do what the world feels like. Don't make a video with all of your family because you see other people doing it. And it seems like you're creating unity. Like, I've always been a wolf. That's why they call me Ralph. That's German for wolf, right? So, like, I've always been someone that just shares, but I don't really want to, my whole family, I don't feel the need for them to know what I'm doing. I don't even want to bring them into it. Like, I'm so happy doing what I'm doing that I'm happy for what they're doing. But at the same time, I'm not in resistance to sharing. But then, once again, I also know that I have to dive deep as well with that, because there's still blocks like we all have with our family. Because we can say, okay, I'm this, and then our family can go and say, go and pick the clothes up outside. And you're like, oh, shit. I've just been owned by my mother, who sees you as this little girl. You know, Teal's mother sees Teal as this little girl. Like, she doesn't see you as someone who's just inspiring the world. She'll always see you as her daughter.
Yep.
And because of that, with our parents, we can't pretend. You know, we can't pretend at all. It's just not going to happen. So it's like, we are very authentic sometimes in front of our parents in terms of who we, you know, who we are. Like, if you can be authentic, I always tell people, if you can be authentic with your parents, you can be authentic with anyone.
Mm-hmm.
Because those are our guardians. Those are the ones holding the keys. Go to them, get the keys, and run outside and then be free. It all starts with your parents.
Most things do.
Most things do, right? Most things do.
Yes.
You know, because those are the conversations which are the hardest to have. You see, everybody wants to run away from their family. I always tell, go back home. Go and sit with your family. Have a chat with them. Because once you really can air your dirty laundry to your family, not just to the world, you see, you can air your dirty laundry to a stranger, but do you have the courage to air your dirty laundry to someone who you've grown up with, who is now going to see you in a whole new way? And you know that their opinion of you after that is going to affect your entire relationship. It's like someone who's gay, who's coming out to their parents. Do you know how hard that is?
Yes.
A lot of people think it's just like a kind of fashion accessory these days. But if you can do it to your parents, you can do it to anyone.
I encourage people into a solitary night of the soul so that they can figure out who their authentic truth is and then go back when they have that solidity of that truth, because they often get triggered into being inauthentic again around their family unless it's solid enough within themselves that they can walk through the door and actually maintain that. But I completely agree with you that the farthest levels of healing essentially is when you can be authentic with the very people who trained you to be inauthentic.
Right, right. Well, it's almost like the infinity symbol. You know, everything starts where everything ends. You know, we go back to the beginning. You know, a lot of people, they say when they, you know, when they're really grown up, they always go back to where they went to school first, you know, and they love driving through. You know, because we, you know, or not, you know, because it's one of those things, like, certain people, they run away. For me, sometimes I'm always curious, but as well, you know, I'm always glad to see where I am now, you know, and it's like a snake. We are all snake shedding skin. You have to allow yourself to shed skin for a reason. There's a reason why the caterpillar didn't stay the same. You know, metamorphosis is the truth of the universe.
Yes.
And if you're not on board with that, well, deal with it. You know, you can deal with being a caterpillar, but it's not fun.
Yes.
Because even the caterpillar knows that that's not its future. It's just a matter of when. It's destiny.
This has been a very good conversation.
Thank you for being... Really, no, I have to say this to everyone. You are someone who I even look to for inspiration, for motivation, and really just how powerful you are in not only in inspiring women, but the whole planet. I always receive messages about you.
Really?
And also, oh yeah, you know, just how you're impacting their lives. And really, I always say you don't want to go out like a Vincent Van Gogh. You don't want to create all this amazing artwork, but not see the amazingness of your own artwork. You want to actually be a Vincent van Gogh that says, actually, yeah, this is the masterpiece. I know it's amazing. And that's the next stage where you actually realize how amazing you are and you don't even apologize for it.
That sounds wonderful.
Right.
I have a workshop for those of you who are interested, besides everything else that I'm doing, which is always nuts. You can find that stuff on www.tealswan.com. I post everything on Facebook as well. I'm doing a bunch of synchronization workshops. I'm actually doing an online workshop this coming Sunday. Now I can't add up the dates. What is that? It's Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So that'd be 28th. The 28th of June. So if you want to tune into that, all the details will be on the website. Besides that, just stay tuned, I guess. And you heard it from both of us. I'm going to say it, then you're going to say it. Air your dirty laundry.
Air your dirty laundry. You have to air your dirty laundry. You have to air your dirty laundry. Also, you can find my videos on ralphsmart.com. Go to Amazon, get the book. Don't get it. I don't care if you want it. Get it. Don't get it. I don't mind. Okay, have fun. And so much love.
I love you.
So much. Love you. Love you too, always. Peace.